Thank you. Hundreds of years before Jesus was even born, the prophet Isaiah says a child will be born, a son will be given. The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor. Hundreds of years before he was born, Isaiah is even setting the stage, and he's saying, there's something about Jesus that's going to be wonderful. Wonderful. Not fearful, not terrifying, but wonderful. Filled with what? Wonders. That there are things that Jesus does in our lives that make you kind of stand back and it's like, wonder. Salvation, healing, provision, miracles. We don't just sing and praise and worship just to kind of go through the motions, but we set the stage for the reality that Jesus wants to come and do wonderful things, good things in your life. So Jesus, we thank you for your presence that's here. We thank you for the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit that resides within us as a believer. But Father, we thank you that when we come in a special way and we gather corporately, that God, your presence is in this place. And that, Lord, you want to do things that are far exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ever imagine or think of or hope for. Lord, I thank you that you have wonderful things in store for our lives, not just corporately, but individually. So, Father, we thank you for your word that's going to challenge us this morning. I thank you for your word that's going to edify and build us up today. Lord, I thank you that you are here to empower us and equip us for the things, God, that you have in store for us this week. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Well, we're gonna dismiss our kiddos. It's great to have you guys in here. You guys can head to your class today and then you may be seated. It's great to see you here today. And Trust, let's go ahead and give it up for our kids. It's great to have them in for worship this morning. And I'll tell you what, you know, as we were summarizing our 2017 in our celebration meeting, I was just so pleased to see that, you know, the area that we spent the most in local ministry, kind of in the context of Access, was what? It was with our kids. And it's investing in the next generation. So, right? They don't get a junior Holy Spirit. They're not the church for tomorrow. I mean, God has awesome things in store for our kids today, like even right now. And so we just are so appreciative of our kids and all of you. If you serve in our kids' ministry, just raise your hand, just at least once a month. Look at how many people serve. You guys are awesome. Our ushers are going to come this morning, and we want to take a minute and welcome those that are guests. Appreciate you being here this weekend and taking time to join us as they make their way forward. If you are here for the first or second time, haven't received one of our gift bags, as they begin to make their way back, if you don't mind just kind of signaling them by raising a hand, why don't you go ahead and do that? And we want to put a gift bag in your hand this morning as they begin to make their way back. So let's welcome those that are guests today. And I think we need to get a couple more bags over here. But thanks for joining us. With that bag is a card that says, Welcome to Access Church. If you could take some time and fill that out over the next few minutes, and you can drop that off in our offering in a few moments. And as a guest, that's your gift to us. We believe that we're a church that has something for you, and you're not here today for us to get something from you. So you can drop that card off. We'd love to send you a follow-up gift this week in the mail as well. As our ushers come, they're going to distribute our worship registers. Thanks for taking time to fill those out. There's a prayer card in there if you'd like our team to be praying with you throughout the week. And then as well, if you have any questions about age-specific ministry or things like that, you can go ahead and notify us on that card, and we'll have a leader connect with you this week. By way of announcements, just updates, things that are going on, we have Easter invites that are available as you leave today. Take a stack of those and invite some people to join us on Easter Sunday. We're going to have a great Sunday coming up, the 1st of April. It's crazy to think it's already spring, right? In Jesus' name, it's 29 degrees, but it's still spring, right? And so you can take some invites. And then we want to take a minute and just recognize a couple people. If Wendell wants to come forward as well as Megan, and just to kind of update you on some transitions, things that are going on. We talked about this in our celebration gathering. But as you know, we have a leadership team that's established here at the church. And as part of our transition with our leadership team and bringing on new leaders over time, Wendell has just served faithfully from the very beginning stages of Access, has been part of our leadership team, and appreciate his service. And, you know, Wendell has been a gift to us here at Access. And I really believe that, you know, in the leadership context, if you're the smartest person in the room, you need to get some more people in the room. And so Wendell has just been a source of just a lot of great wisdom in our meetings over the last 3 years. And he's got big shoes to fill. And I was talking to somebody about this recently. So he's got big shoes to fill. So what we decided to do, we actually added two leaders to replace Wendell on the leadership team. And so John Potter's here, and he's going to pray in a few moments. But John, would you stand real quick? And you can come forward as well. John's going to be serving on our leadership team. And Ted Lang as well. And Ted's traveling. He's with his son today. And, you know, I was thinking with Ted, Ted has served faithfully on our setup crew from day one. And I can probably count on one hand the amount of Sundays that he's missed in 3 years, that he hasn't been here at 8:30 and just serving and pouring into the ministry here. So he'll pray next week as he's back with us, but I appreciate him. John's going to Mexico this week, and so as he comes forward, John's just going to share real brief about what he's going to be doing in Mexico. As you know, he's been on many trips there, and it's going to be this week, and we want to be praying for him.
I'll be leaving Saturday. It was a Saturday to Saturday trip. There's a team from Minnesota, no one I've ever met before, or Dave Smith, the missionary we've worked with, or Pastor Gary, the pastor in New Hampshire that we work with. We haven't met these folks, but they've kind of caught the vision of what we're doing in Chetumal at the Bible College, and they're going to come and help us for a week with ongoing progress that's needed for that property. So that's what we'll be doing for the week.
Yeah, and so be praying for John as he's traveling. He has an awesome time as he is in Mexico. And another transition as well is Megan has been working for just over a year with our K through 5 kids. And she has just poured just her heart out into our K through 5 class and those kids. And we wanted to mention as well that she's going to be transitioning. She's going to be helping out in a variety of the kids' rooms periodically. And she'll be teaching as well periodically in the K through 5th area. But we just appreciate just so much of your, you know, she's just continued to pour out and to invest in our kids. And we do have a gift for you guys that we wanted to just give you on behalf of the church. And I felt like I couldn't give you like a frou-frou bag. So, but we just appreciate you guys. We honor you guys and just believe that God has just awesome things in store for you. So we wanted to share that with Megan because she's going to be in here more often. And Josh, her husband, is part of the leadership team. So you'll see them praying more often and being involved in ministry this room as well. And so if Wendell, if you want to come over and just pray for just the transition that we have with our leaders, and then in a minute, John's going to pray as well for the offering. So, yeah.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for your blessings, Lord, the many things you bless us with. Lord, we pray for this transition time for the leadership, Lord, as John and Ted come into the leadership, Lord, that your will be done, Lord, and that they would be faithful to you, that you would cover them and their families with your protection. And we just thank you for what you're going to do for this congregation and what you have for the future, Lord. We give you the praise and the glory. Amen.
Amen. So why don't you go ahead and express your appreciation. Appreciate you guys very much. Ushers are going to come this morning. We're going to prepare to give and receive our offering. Appreciate John. Go ahead. You can pray this morning.
Oh, Jesus, you are amazing. You are wonderful. You are just this one for each one of us, special for each person in here. And Lord, we as we take a moment, we think about our finances, our incomes, our jobs. Lord God, we thank you that you've blessed each family here, each person here individually. And we just ask that as we give a portion back to you, oh God, that you would use it to just help us share your love, and that you would place these finances in every place that you would want it to go, that would be your heart that we listen to when the choices are made of where this money goes, Lord God. And we just thank you, Jesus, that we can offer up a portion to you right now. In your name we pray, amen.
God is so good. This week, many of you know, my son was home. And you know, the enemy likes to just stop us up every now and again. And this week I have been saying, in the name of Jesus, that's not the way it's going to be in this house. My God is my provider, and my God is the protector of my children. And my God shed his blood so that we can all be safe. And saved and whole. And so this whole week, as I'm battling one way, the song "Great Is Thy Faithfulness" just kept rising up. Great is your faithfulness, Lord. You are faithful to me. You are faithful to my kids. You keep them safe. So if you know the song, which I know many of you do, please sing. And if you don't, know that God is faithful in whatever situation you are in. Wherever it goes, however it goes, God is faithful, and he is always there and always caring. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. They fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Thank you. God is faithful, right? Right? All the time. Yeah, all the time. You say, well, I don't feel like that sometimes. It's not about how you feel. Right? God's faithful. So, you know, just in the area of giving, God's faithful. I mean, you look back and see God's favor and his blessing over your life, and I'm not going to talk about giving this morning because the time is now, right? Just to bring you up to speed, over the next several weeks, what we're going to be doing, I just had a wonderful trip. Ashley and I went away with our family and with Pastor Ella this week to Pittsburgh, and just went to some revival services and just had an awesome time in Pittsburgh. And my kids are still recouping. The services we went to, they were getting over usually like 11:30, 11:45 at night, and we were feeding our kids, you know, at midnight in the hotel, and just had an awesome time. But just to see, people are hungry for God. I mean, just hungry for God. To be in a place that was just jam-packed every night, people just pursuing God, and just to see some awesome things take place. We don't want to settle for less, but contend for more, right? Contend for more. Over the next several weeks, what we're going to be talking about is the time is now. What I want to do is talk about the subject of urgency. Just say that word, urgency. I want to talk about the subject of urgency and almost look at a couple key areas from the book of Acts through the lens of urgency. And we'll do that this week and next week. And then we'll pause for 2 weeks. I'm going to share with Pastor John Schrock at the end of the month. We're going to be talking about Jesus' last words on the cross. We're going to do that together as a team. And then we'll have Easter Sunday. And then we'll jump back into urgency through the month of April. And then have a great friend of the ministry. Pastor Gary's going to be with us in April as well. It's going to be awesome. So I'm really looking forward to that. But, you know, I've been thinking about different seasons of urgency that we have in our lives. We had a couple this past week from Access. They had a baby. And just celebrating, you know, a lot of new kids. And I saw early in the week, I got on Facebook and I saw a picture of them getting ready to go to the hospital. And the subject line said, "Today's the day, here we go." You know, she was here Sunday morning. I kind of saw her. She's going to hate me for even talking about this because I didn't talk to her about this. So I kind of waddle out the back towards the end of service Sunday. And then I get on Facebook Monday, and it's like, "Today's the day," you know, excited, ready to roll, with a sense of urgency or expectation. You know, nothing prepares you as a parent. You can have 5 kids, and it's like the 6th. You know, you have the bag packed, and you're ready to go. But, like, when that moment comes, there's that sense of urgency. There's something exciting, and you basically will drop everything for like the task that's at hand, right? Nobody goes into labor and the husband's like, "Well, you know, I got a couple things to do, a wrap up around the house, and then maybe I'll see you over there tomorrow," right? It's like, you know, you drop everything, and there's that sense of urgency. And on the flip side of that, maybe some of you, you know, are in the later years of your life, and you have those seasons of urgency when you pick up the phone. And it's that call about the aging parent or the aging grandparent. And they say, you know, "Today's the day." Or they're in the hospital, or we need to call, you know, the doctor. And all of a sudden you have that sense of urgency. You know, and it's interesting to think, you know, that there are people in life based on their career path that they kind of live with that sense of urgency as far as their career. They're always ready. They're always available to rescue, to help in a moment of need. We have somebody connected with our congregation that's a medic on the life flight helicopter in town. And I mean, the second he steps into the office, he's ready to roll. It's like that sense of urgency. We have others of you that work in the emergency room department or perhaps like a surgeon. And it's like the second you're in that role, like you're prepared and you have that sense of urgency and you're prepared and you're ready to roll. It'd be like a fireman or something like that. But, you know, as I was thinking about that, you know, they wake up in the morning just like you and me, right? They roll out of bed and they may have a busy schedule, but you know, I don't know that they step into that sense of expectation and urgency until they're in the hospital, they're at the fire station. I mean, they're in the emergency department, and it's like that's when they're in the zone. You know what I'm saying? They're in the zone. What I want to challenge you with over the next several weeks is, and I want to put this idea out there that I want to submit to you, that the moment you accepted Jesus in your life, that there was to be this shift that took place, and there was to be a newfound level of expectation. There should be this new kind of level of urgency within you. And it's one of the great paradoxes of our faith, because the reality is that when you come to Christ, the Bible talks a lot about the rest of the Lord and the peace that passes all understanding. And so on one end, you're to be at rest and you're to have a sense of peace. But on the other side of the equation is like that sense of expectation, that sense of urgency. And it's not that you pick one or the other, but I believe that it's both end. And in life, it's important that you identify the things that really matter most and live with a sense of now is the time, or a sense of expectation or urgency. I mean, if you had the cure to brain cancer, you would live your life with a sense of urgency. If you had a fail-proof model to guarantee return on investments, you would live with a sense of urgency. You would want everybody to know and understand that which you know and understand. If you were a mechanic and you saw a vehicle in the parking lot this morning, that if an issue wasn't addressed, there was the strong possibility that somebody in this room could lose their life in an accident, you would walk into this place with a sense of urgency, trying to figure out exactly whose vehicle it belonged to. And yet, as the people of God, as Christians, we have the cure to sin. We have the model of like provision and protection in life. We have the solution for where people will spend eternity. And yet, why in the world is it that we don't at times live with like that sense of urgency or that sense of expectation? So we're going to talk about this over the next few weeks from the book of Acts, which is where we find our model for ministry. And I want to connect this kind of in our culture today. And so here's the big idea is I believe that if you took a brand new Christian, I mean, somebody that didn't grow up in church, somebody that never read the Bible, this is interesting to think about. That if you took a brand new Christian and you gave them the Gospels and you gave them the book of Acts, not a church person, not somebody that's read a lot of Christian literature, like you just gave them Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John and Acts, and you said, sit in a room for 30 days and read this. I can guarantee you that they would not come out of that room with the same theology that sometimes we acquire over time. They wouldn't walk out of that room with a sensationist theology that the gifts of the Holy Spirit ceased with the book of Acts. There's not a chance that they would walk out of that room with that type of theology. They wouldn't walk out with this idea that maybe Jesus wants to heal. Absolutely no way. If for 30 days a brand new person read Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. And I would say I can guarantee you that they would not walk out with a theology that didn't say, you know what, we live with this sense or are to live with this sense of urgency and expectation as a Christian. And so our theology is not shaped by things, you know, over time, but we strive to raise our expectation to God's word in our lives. And I believe that the Holy Spirit, through the book of Acts, he infused this sense of urgency in the early church. And before we get to Acts chapter 1, I want to put a quote that I read recently on the screen. It's an old quote, but it says, we ought to be living as if Jesus died yesterday, rose from the dead this morning, and is coming back this afternoon. That's what urgency is. And if this was a principle or this was something that you actually embraced, I believe this was the heart of the early church. They lived with this sense of urgency. Think about if you really thought Jesus died yesterday, how grateful would you be for that which he's done for you? If you really believed as if he like rose from the dead this morning, how passionate, how filled with a sense of urgency would you be to think that he was coming back this afternoon? Who would you want to forgive? Who would you want to share Christ with? I believe, like, welcome to the book of Acts, because that was not just the book of Acts, but I believe that's like the template for ministry moving forward in the life of the early church and should be our mentality today. And it's a perspective that shapes everything. Urgency, urgency, urgency. Together, the book of Luke and Acts kind of form this seamless account of how the early church, the followers of Jesus, essentially Acts 17:6 says they turned the world upside down. They took the good news of the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus to the ends of the earth. And before Luke shares about this rapid growth or expansion of the gospel, he gives these two truths. Number one, he gives the indisputable fact of Jesus' resurrection. That it's a historical fact, and Luke talks about that. And then secondly, he gives the indispensable presence of the Holy Spirit a huge emphasis. Because in these two things, you have hope and you have power. You have hope in the reality that Jesus is alive. Easter is not just this one time. You and I should have this idea of resurrection living. So you have great hope that Jesus is alive. And if he's alive, there's a whole lot of things that you can hang on to. But you also have power as he talks about the Holy Spirit. These are like the two strong foundations in the life of the early church. And so in Acts chapter 1, we know that Jesus has already opened the minds of the disciples to the Old Testament teachings. But now it's almost like there's a few lessons that they haven't learned, and that Jesus is now going to spend some quality time with them after the resurrection for a short period of time to teach them for 40 days, just some early preparatory things before he was going to leave the earth. So he wanted to instruct them personally. And they didn't necessarily know when he was coming. I mean, he was kind of coming and going and stuff. But I believe the believers that he's speaking to, is like he chose them to be a witness of the resurrected Christ. And that emphasis of them seeing him personally was now, through the Holy Spirit that was poured out, going to empower them to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. And so in Acts chapter 1, we have Jesus's last day on the earth. And so he gathers them together. And if you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Acts chapter 1 as he talks about the promised kingdom. Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 7. If you need 3 points, sorry. We're just going to walk through a couple verses in the book of Acts today. So we'll stick there. Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 7. It says, they gathered around Jesus and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the dates. So this word is chronos or chronology. He says, it's not up to you to know the times or the dates that who? The Father has set by his own authority. Now the disciples, as Jesus is about to leave, they're still talking about this earthly kingdom. It was a theme throughout the Gospels, and now the resurrected Christ is there, and they're still kind of talking about this because they had this strong political view that the kingdom of God was going to be set up and established on the earth, and I think they believed that it was going to happen in their lifetime. And they were concerned about the position. They were concerned about the privileges, being loyal Jews. They longed to see this established kingdom and their enemies defeated. They wanted to see the glorious kingdom of the Messiah come, where he would rule and reign. And the message of the kingdom was the focus of Jesus post-resurrection with the disciples. And the best way with this whole kingdom theology stuff is to look at it through two different lenses. And the first lens is that it's already now. Go ahead and say that. It's already now. That the kingdom is already now. The promised kingdom is present only in part. The book of John chapter 3 verse 3 says that you can't even see it until you're born of God. So last week we talked to people that were blinded to truth. So there are some things about the kingdom of God that are established within our hearts as believers, that people are blinded to that reality. They can't see it until they come to Christ. And the kingdom of God, it's already now, it's in our hearts. Luke chapter 17, verses 20 through 21, it says, once on being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus said, the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed or seen through natural eyes. Nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst. Or in essence, he's saying, the kingdom of God is within you as a believer. So it's already here. When Jesus returned to heaven, the kingdom remained in the hearts of true believers through the presence of the Holy Spirit. And so you're an American Christian today, right? If you're a citizen of America, you're an American Christian, but you don't operate by the authority of that kingdom. You don't align your life by the principles of that kingdom. The kingdom of God, the Bible says, is not in your mind. It's not something that's passed down by the government, but the kingdom of God is actually something that's established within your heart as a believer. So it's already here, but it's not yet. And so there's an element of the kingdom of God that's promised that he would ultimately reign, and but it's not here yet. The culmination of the kingdom is not fully realized until Jesus returns again. As we're watching and waiting, that's when that kingdom stuff is going to be fully realized. And Jesus, as the disciples are saying, you know, talk more to us about the kingdom and all of this stuff. It's Jesus isn't rebuking them for keep asking about the kingdom. But God is basically saying it's not up to them to try to pinpoint the exact specifics to speculate the kingdom. And the idea here you'll see on the screen is that we're not to be fascinated about the future at the expense of being passionate about the present. And so as Jesus is about to leave, they're all still focused on this earthly kingdom that's going to be established. And Jesus is saying, don't focus on the one day it will be established. Focus on the already that's within your heart. And be passionate about the kingdom of God that you carry right now. He says, it's not up for you to know the times or the dates that who? The Father has set by his own authority. That's not to be our primary focus as the New Testament church. I mean, we long and we wait for the soon returning Christ. But until then, we focus on that which matters most. I used to have some people that would give me Charisma magazine. And you know, there was so much kingdom speculation that was part of, you know, all of these pop books and all these, you know, trying to like nail down, like, we know he's coming, it's going to be March 5th at like 6 a.m. And you know, you got all these studies and all this. And I used to look at Charisma magazine. I just used to get like sick and tired of it. And one day I took the magazine on my desk and actually ripped out every page that talked about books and people studying Chronos, trying to nail down. I mean, the Bible says that we'll know the signs and all of those things. But like, we're not fascinated about that. And I remember ripping out over 50% of the magazine. Because there's a lot of fascination out there for things related for the end times. And yet, if it's not producing passion for the present, I think we miss the mark. Jesus is looking at the disciples. He says, it's not up to you to like nail all of those things down. So I'll tell you, just as a pastor, and I'm not the guy that reads all of the pop books on, you know, the latest, you know, whatever the moons are and whatever, just all that stuff. So if you say to me, Zach, you know, have you read the latest end times book on, my answer is going to be no, 100% of the time, because I'm not fascinated by that stuff. Thank Jesus, he's going to return. But the first end times book that's focusing on Chronos that I'll actually read and value is the one that donates 100% of its proceeds to worldwide evangelism. Because that's somebody that actually grasps the heart of end times. So as you study the end times, if it's not producing a passion to reach the lost, and it's not producing within you a sense of like, take your life seriously, like live with intentionality, then I really think you're wasting your time focusing on speculation. So Jesus says to the disciples, it's not for you to know the things that the Father has set by his own authority. And now in verses 7 and 8, I feel like there's this transition that's taking place where he's going to establish something here in his last words that's to reorient their perspective of the future, and almost like it's sowing seeds of urgency within them. The sense of urgency of the coming kingdom and the second coming. So Jesus almost like sidesteps this conversation about earthly kingdoms and the divine timetables, and he reminds them that to be a spirit-filled witness and to take the message everywhere. And that this was to revolutionize, you know, everything that was to take place with them moving forward. So he speaks of the spiritual kingdom that's within our hearts, that's established within us. But then he says, it's not for you to know, not to you, like intellect. It's not for you to know the times and the dates that the Father established. So instead of trying to figure it all out, he's like saying, it's kind of outside your jurisdiction. There are signs that you look for and for the fulfillment and all of those things. But we don't watch and wait for the Lord to return, like, Lord, get me out of this situation. Like, Lord, just rescue me from the earth, right? Here's what he says in verse 8. So it's not for you to know. It's not an intellectual thing. But he says, but you're going to receive. So the idea is like impartation here. It's not about knowing, but he's saying that there's something that you're deficient in that I need to impart into your spirit. That you will what? Receive power. When the Holy Spirit comes on you, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. I mean, this is a key verse for all of us. We talk about this often. And we will continue to talk about it often. Somebody said to me years ago, they said, you preach things until people are sick and tired of hearing it. Because when they're sick and tired of hearing it, they're starting to just get it. So he says, it's not for you to know, but it's for you to receive. Now, I love this about, you know, the local church as a pastor. I love this. Because in a room like this here today, all of us have different passions, right? So there's somebody here, I'm sure, that's passionate about sewing, like sewing stuff. And then there are some of you that the idea of sewing stuff, like you're like, oh. But you enjoy painting. And the person that's sewing is thinking about painting. They're like, how in the world are you passionate about painting? The idea or the thought of like doing that is just, ugh. There are some of you that have a career where you thrive getting up in front of students and talking and sharing. There are others of you that terrifies you because you're passionate and you love sitting behind a desk, right? There's a lot of variety and diversity within the context of the local church. And so what one person's passionate about, one person's called to, another person's dreading, and the thought of them doing is like, you know, and I would submit to you this morning that you don't just have passions and you don't just have careers, but God uniquely places individuals together with a diversity of passions and careers because the kingdom potential that you can reach in this room is something that's just fascinating when you really think about it. So we don't come together as a group of like, we're all the same. Like, I don't want anything like that. The idea is that we're all passionate about different things. You all have careers that are diverse. And yet those passions and those careers are God-given avenues to fulfill the Great Commission in our context, in our community, spiritually thinking. But it takes a sense of urgency to begin to see your passions and to see your careers as a God-given assignment for you to fulfill. So he says, it's not for you to know. It's for you to receive. He talks about the power of the Holy Spirit. We're going to talk about that next week and the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it's not just like a one-time experience, but he talks about constantly being filled. And we see the life of the early church, these ordinary men doing extraordinary things for God, doing extraordinary things for God. Because the Spirit of God wasn't just simply at work in their minds, but it was imparted to them, and they changed the world and modeled what it's to be like for you and I moving forward in ministry. You'll see on the screen that I said that the ministry of the Holy Spirit is not a luxury, but it's an absolute necessity. It's not a luxury for a few select people, but but it's an absolute necessity. It empowers you to begin to see your passions as God-given opportunities. It empowers you to begin to see your career as a God-given opportunity to reach people with the gospel. There are some things that only the Spirit of God's going to do through your life. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's what? It's by the Spirit. The word witness over 29 times in the book of Acts is used. You will be what? My witness. A witness isn't, you know, somebody that decides they want to, you know, throw their 2 cents in about a scenario. But a witness is somebody that's called to share that which they've seen and they've experienced. It's not just your opinions, but a witness is you're called to share what you've seen and what you know. And the resurrected Christ appears to the disciples, and they're so empowered by the Spirit, they're so, you know, thrust out in launching in ministry as witnesses that they lay down their lives for the sake of the gospel. And a lot of times we hear about, you know, soul winning, and we hear about evangelism. We think people like Billy Graham, you know, the amazing people that are gifted in evangelism. And, you know, the book of Ephesians talks about the gifts to the local church, gifts of being an evangelist. But what happens, I think, a lot of times is we tend to interpret Scripture through the prism of our experience. And I don't want to dog this too much because I don't want you to have, you know, I'm not criticizing this. But a lot of times our experience with evangelism are large events that you bring people to, or they're programs. And so, and they have their place. And many of you, you've probably had your lives transformed in an event or a program. But I would submit to you that that's not the New Testament model for evangelism. They have their place. There's fruit in those ministries. But you can spend your life inviting people to programs and events and still not be a witness. And so we don't interpret the lens of Scripture through our own experience, what we were brought up with. But we fight to raise our experience with the standard of God's word. And that's the early church. Every one of them was a bold witness. I mean, if you received a subpoena and had to stand before a judge to share about an accident that you saw, I don't care how much spring cleaning you got going on. You know, could you imagine you get a subpoena? We need you to come testify. We need you to share what you saw and experience. And you're like, well, got a lot of things going on this week. But judge, I just, you know, I appreciate the opportunity, but I'll go ahead and pass. No, it doesn't work that way. It's like the expectation. You're called. You share about what you've seen and experienced. And that's the New Testament model in the life of the early church. And there was a sense of urgency. It's like Jesus said, there's going to be this period of time. We're going to be my witnesses between my 2 visits to this planet. And so in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it gives us kind of a general outline as described as the geographical spread of the gospel. It says Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then to the Gentiles, to the ends of the earth. But it's to start in the context of our homes. And I know a lot of times we get focused on reaching the ends of the earth, and that has its place, to take the gospel to people that have never heard it for the very first time. Their ministries, they're super passionate. They do nothing outside of taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. And I would say the more bold thing to do is take it across the street. Take it across the hallway at work. Don't let the passion to accomplish the mission of the ends of the earth supersede the passion of taking it like across the hallway, across the street. And so we get, you know, in Acts chapter 1, you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria. And so we have kind of the church's mission statement. You'll see it on the screen. I mean, this is like a non-negotiable, right? What does it look like? Well, the people. So what's the task? You and me. What's the power? Well, you receive the power of the Holy Spirit, right? What's the philosophy? What's the approach? You're my witnesses. It's not just a program. It's not just an event, but it's like all of us live life on mission. And what's the plan? You start inward, like throwing a rock in a pond, and the ripples start within and they reach out. Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. So this is kind of like the strategy. But what I want to give you an example of this, because I think a lot of times, you know, we see something like this and it's like we agree with the mission part of it, but I think we lose the mentality part. So I want to ask you a question, do a little interactive thing. If you traveled within the last week or are traveling this week to a place that's outside of, let's say, 30 minutes from State College, or you have a family member that's currently traveling outside of this area at least 30 miles, would you go ahead and just stand? 30 miles or more. So we're going to try to be relatively quick with this. So I'll start. I went to Pittsburgh, okay? Pittsburgh. Where'd you guys go? New York City. Harrisburg. Myrtle Beach. Fort Myers, Florida. Williamsport. Lancaster. You guys. Belleville. How about you guys, Berks? Oh, okay, go ahead. Once I call you, you can sit. Where? How about you guys? Philadelphia. Chicago. Altoona. John. Mexico. Baltimore. Wyoming. Hopefully you're not driving. Oh, Dominican, yeah. Rough life, right? Dominican. South Africa, okay. Harrisburg. Baltimore. Florida. Florida. Gosh, y'all escaping. Cool. Harrisburg. Pittsburgh. All right. Hershey. Delaware. Johnstown. New York. Hershey. So that's a 2-week period of time. That's a lot of places that are represented, isn't it? So the life of the early church, it's so much more than just the ministry of what God does in the context of our community. But, you know, I was thinking, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs 37:23, that the steps of a godly man, woman, child, Christian, that they're actually ordered. Everybody say order. They're ordered by the Lord. You say, well, I don't feel like that. I don't feel like a godly. Well, it doesn't matter how we feel. 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God. So as a Christian, you're holy. You're in right standing with God. Therefore, he orders, he guides, and he directs your steps. Ephesians 2:10. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Not just pray for good works, not just to study about good works or to think about, like, God's got something for you to do. So he orders, he directs our steps. He's got something for you and I to do. It's called be a witness, right? Take the gospel from this place and just like ripples spread out from this place. And what I want to say to you is I think a lot of times we put the mission above the mentality. And so what would happen if we're going to put something on the screen, I think. What would happen if we woke up with the mentality that God actually ordained your steps and our steps to those places within the last 2 weeks? Like, what? More than just mission, like, well, I'll give, you know, and we'll send people to, you know, to bed or wherever, you know, they're going and we'll take the gospel. No, like, put the mentality above the mission. Like, God actually wants to work in your life and through your life. You're not the master of your own movements. You're not. And you can't embrace this kind of New Testament theology and not wake up with a sense of, like, excitement. That, like, God's got something for you to do this week. You say, do, it's all good works. I'm not talking about righteousness, you know. It's not about we do so that we're in right standing with God. It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with what he's called you and I to do. And so we're not simply sent to places, you know, on our own. The Great Commission is just as much a mentality as it is a mission. And you don't just pawn, you know, missions off on other people. I'm proud that we gave almost 100,000 to missions last year. But I'll tell you, I would be doubly enthused, if that's even a word, doubly. No, yeah. I would be, like, really proud. Two times. Yeah. It's not about money. It's about mentality. So I would be doubly, it's a word now. I would be, like, doubly proud to see that we wake up with the mentality that, like, the Lord actually has got some things for us to do. And he's sending you and me, not just to support missionaries, but to be a witness. After that, verse 9, he's taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid them from their sight. You know, just when you think you've seen it all, right? Water to wine, Jesus spits in mud, puts it on a guy's eyes, dies on a cross, rises from the dead. Just when you think it all, you've seen it all. Ascending Jesus, like, he's right there, and the Bible says that as he gets up into the sky, this cloud hides him. You know, the cloud in the Old Covenant symbolizes the glory of God. In the Gospel of Luke, and as Jesus and three of the disciples are at the Transfiguration, a symbol of God's presence was the cloud. And so as Jesus ascends into heaven, and the Bible says that the clouds kind of hid them from their sight, the disciples needed to see Jesus making this transition into the glory of God. It was like another confirmation. Because if he hadn't returned to the Father, he couldn't have sent the promised gift of the Holy Spirit. He couldn't have been Jesus, the interceding high priest. He couldn't have been the advocate. He couldn't have been the glorified head of the church. If they hadn't seen this transition from Jesus going up and now the glory of God is hiding him, if he would have stayed on the earth, his physical presence would have limited the spread of the gospel, physically speaking, because he could only be at one place at one period of time. But now, spiritually speaking, he's going to be with them through the infilling of the Holy Spirit that we read in the book of Acts, through the comfort and the guidance of his Spirit. And in verse 10, it says, they're looking intently into the sky. Jesus ascends, the clouds representing the glory of God hide him, and then suddenly, and I like that this word's used, because I think a lot of times we want to see, you know, things happen strategically. Well, Lord, here's what it's going to look like. We already got this thing figured out. 1 + 1 = 2. 2 + 2 = 4. We're going to do this, and it's going to equal this. And we got this, like, system that's laid out. I think a lot of times, you know, we want things to happen, and it's not just systematically, but strategically. But, like, all of a sudden, the Bible says, like, God suddenly. And that's one of the themes you'll read in the Bible. There are things that God does, and it's not strategically. It's not, like, systematically, like, God, you know, here's the thing, color within the lines. No, he's not confined by, like, you know, things that we come up with. All of a sudden, it's like, boom, suddenly. The disciples are staring up into the sky. We don't necessarily know what that's all about. Probably in awe and wonder. They're probably just, you know, amazed. Like, just when we thought we've seen it all, you know, now he's got to ascend to the heavens. And like, you know, and they're like in awe and wonder. And then suddenly, two men, not feathered beings hovering in the sky, they come descending through the clouds. It's like all of the sudden, boom, suddenly, two men are standing like right there with them. They're like, wow, just when we haven't seen enough, you know. Two men, all of a sudden, they're standing right there. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you, this is like God's first divine rebuke. You know, he's a sent. Why are you standing here? Why are you looking into the sky? The same Jesus who was taken into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go. The book of Revelation says, every eye will see him. So this isn't some cute Jesus ascending and he's coming and he's going to cutely descend. That's not even probably a word. Like cutely descend. No, the Bible says like when he comes again, he's coming back the same way. But it's not just a few people who are going to see him. Every eye, the Bible says, will see him. And I believe that when these two angels are standing there, there was like this great sense of motivation. It was like gas was now dumped on the fire of urgency. C.S. Lewis says, the great thing is to be found at one's post as a child of God, living each day as though it was our last, but planning as though our world might last 100 years. So we should be ready for the sudden return of Christ. 1 Thessalonians 5:2, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the suddenly. And we should be ready, not by standing around, staring in the sky. Shouldn't be standing around in awe and wonder of all that God's done there. There's a place for that, but we don't live in that. The Bible says in Mark chapter 16, verse 20, the disciples went out and they what? They preached everywhere. They lived life on mission. It's like every day they got up and they were a witness. Every day they got up and they shared about Christ. And the Lord, what? He worked with them and they confirmed not their stories, but he confirmed his word that was spoken with signs, wonders, and miracles. That was the life of the early church. That's what we model ministry moving forward. There was a sense of urgency and expectation. As the worship team comes, you know, my curious side had this thought this week. I wonder if they ever looked at the clouds differently. Because this wasn't 2018, where we're in rooms like this with no windows. In office, it seems like, you know, most places now, they don't have windows in them. Most of our lives are lived not on the outside like the life of the early church, but they're on the inside. And I wonder if there was a moment that they ever looked up into the heavens and saw the clouds representing the glory of God. And it was just kind of like ordinary living. No way. No way. I think every second that their eyes looked up to the heavens and saw the clouds, it was that reminder. Just as he went, he will come back. Just as he went, he will come back. And I think it just continued to stir and infuse a sense of urgency in the early church. They didn't know if he was coming back in 10 minutes. They didn't know. I believe that they actually thought it was happening in their lifetime. They lived with like that sense of urgency. Like he could be coming back tomorrow. And the power and authority that they started operating in that we'll talk about over the next few weeks. It's just amazing when you think about it. What happens when you live with a sense of urgency? You know, you fast forward to chapter 7. Stephen. He's speaking to Israel's elders, the leaders, the officials. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit that was within him, he's boldly declaring things. I mean, he knows full well, outside of a miracle, he's losing his life for what he's saying. You stiff-necked people. Well, I know we need grace. I know we need love. I know we need... But there's a place for truth. You stiff-necked people, he says to the religious leaders. These are like the people that totally missed, like, just missed the Messiah. They missed, the whole point. You always resist the Holy Spirit. You ignored the prophets. You killed those who predicted the coming Messiah. You received and you rejected the law. The Bible says as they hear this, it's like they're almost manifesting a demon. It says they're furious and they're gnashing teeth at him. They're furious. They're gnashing teeth of. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, what does he do? And I kind of am a visual person, right? It's like he's boldly declaring, like he knows what's happening after this. But the Bible says he looks up to the heavens. And he sees the glory of God, Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And as he's looking up into the heavens, like he knows, he's like, Jesus just went up there. They said he's coming back soon. And as he's looking up to the heavens, the leaders cover their ears. They're yelling at him. They rush towards him. They grab him, drag him out into the city streets. And as he falls down on his knees, about to lose his life, he pleads to God that God wouldn't count the people's sin against them. Just like Jesus on the cross. Father, Lord, they don't know what they're doing to me. Father, forgive them. Forgive them. They're rushing to this man with stones. He's like, Lord, they don't know what they're doing. Don't count this against them. The Bible says he falls asleep. He's escorted into the very presence of God by death. The life of the early church was marked by living as though Jesus died yesterday, rose from the dead this morning, and was coming back this afternoon. That's why they were willing to give their lives for the sake of gospel. If you gave a new believer, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the book of Acts, our model for ministry, you said for 30 days, just read, study, digest this. Not a chance that they're going to walk out of that room believing that the acts of the Holy Spirit ceased to exist in our day. Not a chance they would walk out of that room without a sense of urgency and a passion for Jesus coming back. When's the last time? Like we looked up to the heavens, like, wow, Lord, you could come back today. You could come back tomorrow. And that should fuel, number one, a life of intentionality. Tomorrow is not just tomorrow. Tomorrow is a day that God's ordering and he's directing and he's guiding your steps. He's got good things in store for you. He's wonderful. He's wonderful. But he's got some stuff for us to do. Intentionality. And I believe it would fuel a passion to reach the lost. Missions isn't just something we fund. It's something we are. You and I are witnesses. In our Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, take the gospel to the ends of the earth. Would you stand with me this morning? Would you close your eyes? Maybe you're here today. You don't have a relationship with the Lord. The Bible says, come to me all who are weary. You carry heavy burdens and I'll give you rest. You can come to Jesus and experience the peace of God. you can have the assurance that if he comes back today, you'll be in heaven with him for eternity. You'll know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God loves you, that he's your father. He's got good things in store for his kids. Maybe you haven't committed your life to Jesus and you're here today, or perhaps you're here and you once were on fire for the Lord, you once were passionate for God, but for whatever reason or excuse, you've just kind of like, you've lost your first love, you've lost your passion for God. You just need to recommit your life to him this morning. If that describes your condition today, would you just raise your hand? I want to pray for you in a minute, as our leaders are going to come in a few minutes as well. But would you just raise your hand here? Anybody, you want to give your life to Jesus for the first time? If not, the second area that I want to challenge you is you're here today, but you've lost kind of that sense of urgency, that sense of expectation. Monday to you is like what Monday was to you last week and the week before. But you just need somebody to pray for you. Like that, it's more than just like speaking God's word and like you figured it out in your mind and you're going to wake up tomorrow and it's like, game on. No, there's like something that needs to be prayed into you. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, he's just going to fill you to overflowing. You're going to look at life through a different lens. Not Western kind of casual Christianity where it's like, we go to church, check that thing off like I check off the Republican box when I vote and just move on. It's way like that. It's not what we live for. We live for Jesus, and we're his witnesses. We're empowered by his Spirit, and our steps are ordained by the Lord. And so if you want prayer, would you just come forward? I'm going to invite our leaders to come forward as we begin to worship, and then I'll pray a prayer of dismissal in a minute. Would you just come if you want prayer for anything specifically that's going on in your life? I'd encourage you to come as Aaron begins to sing. We'll pray for you. You need healing in your body. You need a miracle. Would you come? Raise your hands. It's just a sign of surrender to the Lord today. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, you said the grass withers, the flower fades, but that God, your word endures forever. Father, look, I pray you would take the word that was spoken today through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would breathe even more life on it. Lord, that there wouldn't be one person that walks out of these doors into a normal Monday, but that, Father, you would shift their mentality. Father, I bless them as missionaries in our community, our Jerusalem. Lord, we don't pay people to come reach our community. God, you've sent us to our community. We don't push that off on somebody else, but God, we recognize the divine assignment, Lord, that you've placed within each one of us. We realize the passions that you've given us. We acknowledge the careers and the callings that we have. And Father, we pray that you would use our lives this week as you see fit. Lord, that we would live with boldness. Lord, that we wouldn't be afraid. But that, God, you would restore back within us boldness, a sense of urgency. Father, we thank you that you're coming back. But, Lord, our hearts is not to be looking into the sky waiting. But, Lord, our heart is to be working and to sharing Christ, to praying for the sick, and to see, just as you said, these signs shall follow them that believe. And so, Father, I pray that you would use our lives this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You have a great week. See you back next Sunday.